And good afternoon and aloha, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us today at the kickoff panel for the Gals with Lay Cracking the Code first session. We have a stellar lineup today of powerful, brilliant, and fearless women that will hopefully set the tone for today's workshops with remarks touching on the importance of women in STEM fields, the importance of mentoring and amplifying each other, and insights from their own experiences. Science, as with all fields, is improved through diversity of thought, through equal representation of gender, race, and lived experiences. However, only about a quarter of technology and research jobs are currently held by women. And women are systemically underrepresented in tenure-track professorships, STEM awards and honors, and speaking invitations, among others. There are systemic barriers that discourage women from pursuing careers in science and technology, but we can learn how to better address these inequities from hearing about the stories and successes of the women on this stage, who have in turn learned from generations of women pushing boundaries before them. Although women are now better educated than men, studies using census data from 1950 to 2000 in the United States showed that when women enter fields in greater numbers, the pay declines for the very same jobs that more men were doing before. There was also substantial evidence that employers place a lower value inherently on work that is done by women. On the other hand, when men move into fields that used to be traditionally dominated by women, such as computer programming, both wages and prestige rise. These findings suggest that the problems will not be fixed solely by increasing the presence of women in STEM fields, but that transformative structural changes are needed at all levels in our culture to accurately value the work, STEM or otherwise, that is done by women. This is a huge issue, and I hope we can learn from the experiences and successes of our panelists, who I'll now introduce. Linda Ferrudo is a professor of mathematics education at the University of Hawaii at Manoa. Her research interests include mathematics achievement, quantitative methodology, ethnomathematics, STEM education, and educational access and equity. Lisa Godwin is a creative technologist at the New York Times, facilitating digital transformations, and is the founder of UR Tech in New York, which we'll hear more about today. Holly Liu is a visiting partner at the Y Combinator and the founder of Kabam, a leader in mobile gaming. She was named to Fortune's 10 Most Powerful Women in Gaming. Linda, now I'm going to turn the floor over to you.
Aloha mai kākou. Mahalo for the invitation to speak and for your tremendous efforts around the world. It is truly humbling to be in your presence. In addition to expressing my sincerest appreciation to each of you, I would also like to extend this to our kupuna, our ancestors, and our ohana, families and communities who made it possible for us to be here today. I open with a short video on cracking the code of systemic, societal, and individual barriers to equitable and accessible STEM, particularly mathematics education.
For more than a decade, the University of Hawaii has been developing dynamic educators through hands-on ethnomathematics training, such as sailing aboard the Polynesian Voyaging Society's double-hulled canoes Hikianalia and Hokulea, and using traditional wayfinding to teach measurement and geometry. Ethnomathematics prepares high-quality teachers through real-world applications of teaching and learning mathematics by bridging indigenous wisdom and 21st century skills. Teachers have traveled to the Hawaii Institute of Marine Biology on Mokuoloe, also known as Coconut Island, in Kaneohe Bay to collect algae and study snapping shrimp and other creatures to measure sine curves, wavelengths, and amplitude. The ethnomathematics program at UH Manoa's College of Education is the culmination of years of building the UH Ethnomathematics and STEM Institute under the direction of Professor of Mathematics Education Linda Ferrudo, with support from state and federal funding.
Ethnomathematics inspires classrooms and communities to engage in local, global, national issues that impact our planet, such as climate change, biodiversity of our oceans and our waters, and education and human rights.
ethnomathematics produces results in the classroom.
Ethnomathematics is just the way we should be teaching mathematics, by using culture, by going into our physical environments, and just by doing instead of just listening and, you know, lecturing.
It's made a huge difference. I've been involved in this program since 2015, and so I've watched students go from listening to lectures to actually being involved and wanting to make a difference in their community.
In 2018, the UH Manoa College of Education began offering the first ethnomathematics graduate certificate, making it the first academic program of ethnomathematics in the world. Later that year, the Hawaii Teacher Standards Board approved ethnomathematics as a field of licensure. With additional coursework and requirements, the graduate certificate may be extended to a master's degree in mathematics education.
I think it's fantastic that the Hawaii Teacher Standards Board has added ethnomathematics as a field, because it just validates everything that we're doing. It emphasizes the importance of integrating culture in our school curricula, especially in math, which is a subject that culture isn't really seen in.
Being first in the world means the University of Hawaii is leading the way in this fast-growing field.
In your program is very important because it's opening new ways for research in math education, for research in science, for research which is looked at from a fresh standpoint.
The future vision of the Ethnomathematics program is to strive to be a model for how we learn and teach mathematics that honors all people and places, and to be a catalyst for positive change in the communities which we're endeavoring to serve in Hawaii and around the world.
Sorry, guys. I did not expect to get emotional. As an alum of the East-West Center, I've been so fortunate to be part of a space that honors and celebrates leadership, entrepreneurship, and inspiration. Many of you have been part of this journey with me. It also comes with kuleana, or responsibilities, in the spaces which we occupy and which we're privileged to occupy, and we've been gifted. Today I share a personal story about ethnomathematics, STEM, and voyaging, and connect it to Mala Mohonua, which means caring for the world, all people and places, like Ohana. Over a four-year period, I'm humbly grateful for the opportunity I had to sail on the canoe Hokulea around the world. The purpose of sailing around the world by celestial navigation, the sun, the moon, the winds, cues from nature, was to honor those who had gone before us and to raise the next generation and to care for our planet. My legs included Hawaii to Tahiti, Samoan Islands, Aotearoa, South Africa, Virginia, Washington, D.C., and New York City. One of the most important lessons that I have learned in voyaging is that we cannot change the winds, but we can always change our sails. And when we change our sails, we get to not necessarily where we think we need to be, but exactly where we're supposed to be. When we were sailing around the Samoan Islands, we didn't have the right winds. So we came back early and we filled our time interacting with schools and students. After one presentation on ethnomath and voyaging, a young child stood up and said, "Thank you for teaching us what's not written in our textbooks." I was profoundly moved and I said back to this young child, "Fafta'i telelava, maho nui loa to your kupuna," who had the courage to sail from the Samoan Islands throughout the Pacific to Hawaii. "It's because of you we're here. It's because of you we're able to sail around the world using science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. We remind ourselves that we are one nation on this one oceanic planet that we call home, which is Island Earth. When we get lost, all we need to do is look to the back beam, or metaphorical back beam of Hokulea, which says kapuna kiki, or hold sacred the children. My hope and my vision is that we engage in this structural change that honors the past and raises the next generation to vision beyond the horizon. Mahalo."
Thank you so much, Linda. If you pass that down to Lisa, I'll go ahead and start this one as well. And Lisa, I'll turn it over to you.
Awesome. Aloha, everyone. I just want to say thank you for having me today, and thank you for being present, as I am elated to see so many women here who are invested in their future. So I'm going to start off with cracking the code, and one of the main questions that I've gotten asked since I've arrived today is, what is a creative technologist? So I figure I would start off with explaining exactly what I do, what my title is. As a creative technologist, I oversee a lot of the digital transformations that come across the New York Times. I manage our product development lifecycle and monetize our digital products. So I help the company make money and monetize all of our digital products that are using the latest technologies. So I want to talk about some of the key essentials to help crack the code in the STEM industry. In no particular order, I feel like that education, work hard, create goals, and networking. When I say educate, always be a learner, especially in the STEM field. It is forever changing. It's an evolving door. There's so many innovative technologies that are taking place. Always become a learner. Always, you know, want to perfect your craft. I've been in the industry for about 15 years now, and I still take courses to learn about various technologies that is evolving, because technology is always changing. And that also helps me with the working hard, because imposter syndrome, it is very real. Sometimes you question yourself as, do I belong in this room? Is this for me? Especially in a male-dominated field. The first time I ever experienced imposter syndrome at one of my previous employers, I was a director of technology. It was about 500 employees in the tech organization. I was one of the only women directors, and then a woman of color, the only woman of color. And it was one of like the new orientations that was happening, and I walked into the boardroom, and it was a town hall, so it was everyone that was in the tech organization, and a gentleman asked me, are you the new secretary here to take the board notes? And I was genuinely offended. And you know, I was thinking, actually, I'm the new director of product. I will be deciding what products are released here for this company. So if we could restart this meeting over and you would like to reintroduce yourself, that would be amazing. You know, but after that meeting, that reflection, that imposter syndrome started to sit in with me a little, and I started to question, is this where I'm supposed to be? Is this my field? But it also fueled me to make sure that women behind me and the younger generation would never have to experience something like that. So, and that's what made me start finding my tribe, finding people that will advocate for you within the workplace and outside of the workplace, helping other women, forming those employee resource groups within the companies, finding your tribe outside of the workplace that it will help you. Networking is so important within the STEM industry, especially being a woman. Some of my greatest accomplishments that I was able to achieve within companies were because of other women advocating for me. And I feel like I never had a particular mentor, someone that I actually went to for guidance. I always would look up to my male leadership, because I always had a male in a role over me, and just ask, what did you do to get to where you are? How did you obtain this position? And then I would go study, and I would go apply for those roles, and I would, you know, end up getting them after our interview, which is amazing and I'm grateful for. But I never had a mentor that guided me throughout the tech space, which led me to start You Are Tech. It came up a little weird, which led me to found You Are Tech, which is an independent media property covering the intersection of tech, culture, and education. Our objective is to highlight trends and showcase diversity within tech. We aim to provide information for people to become well-versed within the tech and STEM industry. Also, I have an app that is dedicated to aiding those looking to discover a deeper passion, looking for those to discover a deeper passion within tech and connect with other like-minded individuals for mentorship, something that I lacked when I was coming through the trenches of the technology industry. So You Are Tech helps you navigate tech, helps you figure out who you are, what you want to be within the tech industry. I felt like I held so many different roles within tech before I found my passion. And if I had a mentor that I actually, you know, could go to for advice, I could have skipped that. I could have been focusing on my core passion, which is developing and building out products for monetization, which is something I honestly enjoy doing. So that's what you are, tech. It pairs you with someone that will help you mentor and navigate the tech industry. And that concludes my presentation. Oh, they made my slides really fancy and come in. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lisa, for those remarks. And our last panelist today is Holly Liu. Let me get her slides up here. And Holly, I'll turn it over to you.
Oh,
is that the last one?
No, but it'll show up.
There we go.
Hi, everyone. Welcome. Thank you so much for having me here. And thank you so, I'm so glad that all of you are here in this room to kind of take that moment to reconnect and think about how you are changing the face just by being here, the faces of STEM in science, technology, engineering, and math. You are so needed in this field, and you do belong, no matter what anybody says, what the room says, and what people verbally say. That is just not true. So I wanted to share just a little bit of my story with you guys. I was told I only have 5 minutes, so I'm gonna try to blaze on through here. As mentioned before, I'm co-founder of a company called Kabam. Kabam, as we mentioned, is a mobile gaming company. We make AAA quality games right in your pocket. If you are a Marvel fan and like mobile games, you probably played our largest game, which is Marvel Contest of Champions. We started the company in 2006 as a corporate social networking company, but exited in 2017 as a mobile gaming company to Fox and Netmarble. So as you can tell, success is not a straight linear line, and I'm more than happy to chat a lot more about just the 11 years of that. But what I loved about gaming, that gaming is truly global. It is one of those rare fields that you can have a hit come from anywhere. It's really, really true. In China, we have amazing game developers, Australia, the East Coast, and even here in Hawaii with Tetris. But the problem with gaming, and even one of the things about gaming is us founders did not have a gaming background. So truly, you feel like it is accessible. But what's really funny is you look around the room, the opportunities are not. Around the room, you see a lot of people that don't really look like you, don't behave like you. And even with esports, I have a couple esports folks up there. You know, even though the number of female gamers are changing, it still is highly, highly male oriented. So oftentimes when something is truly global, but the opportunities are not, what do we do? I like to say, when there's no opportunities to take, you need to make these opportunities. And this is what I love about entrepreneurship, is it really looks at the systems and how do we change the system here. Particularly with tech entrepreneurship, oftentimes with the click of the button, she gets to change thousands of behaviors for thousands of readers, right? The behaviors. And I think that that's something very powerful and highly impactful. The first step in making opportunities is putting yourself into the pathways of these opportunities. And I wanted to tell basically two stories of my life of kind of what that happens along with mentorship. So when I first got out of college, I am the daughter of two loving Chinese immigrant parents, but there's really only one pathway. Well, actually three pathways for you. You either become an accountant, a lawyer, or a doctor. Not even an engineer back in my day. And so I followed the path and I wasn't that happy. I became an accountant and I worked at a big five. It was really fabulous. They would fly me into all these wonderful places. And inside, I felt a lot like this. Yeah, that's what I started out with, was help. Inside, I was supposed to be happy, but I wasn't. And oftentimes when you're starting out your career, a lot of people will tell you, find a mentor. But the problem with people like us who are either women or women of color, there's not a lot of mentors that look like us. And in fact, there's never gonna be a mentor that's gonna be exactly the same as you. And you're never, ever really gonna find that. So And not only can you go look for people who want experience, the experiences that you want, but also I highly always recommend that you allow your inner voice and your experiences to be your mentor. I know it's very strange and very Tinkerbellish, but oftentimes when there's nothing around, sometimes inside your gut, you're like, you just know that this is not for you. And that's what I knew very quickly on when I just couldn't get the hang of the ticking and the tying very quickly, or I could, it just was not something that gave me energy. My wake up experience was actually an airplane ride. I was coming back home from a 3-week kind of project, and on the way down, the plane began to pitch at a 45 degree angle, left and right. And it was just like the movies. I don't know, hopefully you don't have to experience these types of things, but it really felt like a near-death experience. The plane started rattling. The guy next to me, who had to have been like, he definitely lived 3 lifetimes. He had to have been 75 years or plus, was so scared he wanted to hold my hand. I knew something was up here. The plane started to pitch back and forth. Then it started to pull up at almost like a 60, 70 degree angle, and then went stable. And once the plane landed to safety, at that point, or as the plane was coming in and it was shaking, the thought in my brain was like, oh my goodness. As I was praying, I was like, I cannot believe I'm gonna die for a three-week job that I just really didn't care about that much. Plus I had 3 weeks of dirty laundry in there. I was like, oh my gosh, this is not good. So once the plane landed to safety, it was my wake up experience to stop having life happen to me and start making life happen for me. And that's immediately when I decided to go back to school and choose a major in technology, the thing I wanted to get close to. I studied information management and systems, and I basically put myself into the pathway of opportunity. It was there at UC Berkeley that I started to learn what product was. I learned about technology. I had to code. I had to create into terms of networking classes. And it was there I met my co-founders. It was there that all these opportunities started to create and to be more open. So when you find yourself trying to crack the code yourself, I encourage you that when there's no opportunities to take, to go ahead and start making those opportunities. Put yourself in that pathway of opportunity. And when you find your life happening to you, or for you, then maybe you should make life happen for you. And that's how you too can crack the code. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Holly. Everyone was so on time, and I've never moderated a panel or even been on a panel where it's been this on time before. So we do have a couple of extra minutes. So maybe I'll just, if Liz is okay, yeah? All right, then I'll just bring up a couple themes and give everyone a couple more opportunities to talk with each other and with the room. So some of the things that came through from all of these stories today, both the very personal, emotional stories of getting to where you are in your career, a lot of what I heard was, again, this lack of mentorship, the lack of people that you can see yourself in. And I saw that as in my career as well. And I think that really focusing on this lack of mentorship and being there for other women as they come up through your career and finding people that you can reach out to is definitely something that can be facilitated through this workshop today as we make connections and as you talk to the panelists and the amazing women that you're meeting throughout the day. Another thing that came through was the imposter syndrome, which I'm not sure if it ever goes away. Maybe people further in their careers can let me know. But you know, after every award you get, after every $10 million grant, you think, oh, I fooled them again. So this is something that persists throughout the career, and I welcome anyone on the panel to speak of imposter syndrome, and we heard a little bit about it, but if it's something that has ever gone down or something that we're all going to be facing.
It never goes away. It's forever there. It follows you around. No matter where you are in your career, like I said, I've been in tech now for over 15 years. Sometimes I still, especially entering into this entrepreneurship space, now building my own startup, I'm like, is this the right decision? Is this what I should be doing? am I ready for this? You still question yourself, no matter how many years of experience you've had, no matter what, I still question myself. Sometimes it's not as frequently as what it used to be, but you all have that moment. We all have that moment of doubt and fear. And that's why I said it's so important to have that tribe of people, to have that circle of people that are gonna advocate for you and cheer you on, motivate you and be there for you and make you feel like I can do this.
Thank you. So Linda, I wanted to ask you, when you were talking, you talked about all these amazing initiatives that you had started, these groundbreaking, world-changing things. But you didn't mention any mentorship or leadership that might have been important in your journey. Were there people that helped you along the way? And I guess you mentioned the East-West Center, but.
Yes. I think I want to connect your question to what Lisa just said. Guys, I'm just like a country girl from Haula. I didn't think I was going to go to college. I didn't think I was going to do, I don't know what kind of future I envisioned for myself, but from a very early age, one thing I did know is that I was loved and I was valued. And in my community, the values that were inculcated within me are loyalty, love, compassion, courage. And so for me, literally and figuratively, when the waves broke over my canoe and I felt like I was lost because I hadn't seen stars in hours and hours, and I was just trying to piece together the clouds in the heaven and the little pukas, the little holes where I could see a few stars, I think I knew who I was, I know who I am, and in the spaces in between when I feel lost, that I can come back to my community and I can come back to the figures who lead, not necessarily by the things they say, because in my community, it's not necessarily what you say, it's how you behave, and your actions convey to everyone that I am a servant leader. I am not asking you to do anything that I'm not willing to do myself. And this is the model that my mentors have shared with me over the years, my academic journey and my journey to today. And so definitely I'm grateful for mentors who show me by example what it means to be a servant leader.
Thank you so much, Linda. So maybe to wind up the panel, I'll just bring it back to some of the remarks that I made in my opening statement about what we're seeing in these studies that women, for example, used to be computer programmers almost exclusively. It was seen as a very menial task. And then as that shifted to being dominated by men, all of a sudden it gained prestige and pay that went along with it. So these are, this is a systemic issue. And so maybe I might ask the panelists if they have any larger overarching insights into these kind of transformational structural changes needed at the highest levels to support not just women in STEM, but women's success in all fields and being equally valued for the work that we're doing. Big question, I know.
So I think absolutely. One of the things, going back to kind of your stat, is that I come from not only California, but I come from Silicon Valley, and those engineers, like, eye-poppingly make so much money. It's ridiculous. I talked to maybe I shouldn't say this. I'll say it. It's on camera. I was talking to a Facebook manager. He had left, and he goes, Holly, you will not believe I am signing bonuses for $5 to $10 million for these kids who just graduated. Oh, please don't leave here to go. No. But, like, and then startups are trying to compete. And this is a computer engineering space where women have dominated from, like, Hidden Figures. So one of the things I do think that is incredibly important is that the women, and I so appreciate you guys here, and as more and more women enter the field, is that we do not forget and we do not erase history, and that we will remember. Because as this next generation comes, I don't want them to say the same thing we're saying, like, oh, there's no role models, but now look at, we have a whole row here, and we're gonna have more and more. So absolutely, I think that not erasing is important. I certainly think one of the biggest things to do on not erasing is honestly help not just the, you know, media and stuff, but like Wikipedia is horrid. Sorry, now this is recorded again. Like 97% of those editors are white men. And I'm so shocked constantly why this dude is considered notable and that woman is not. And it's just, so there are some efforts there if you ever tend towards a kind of that way. I also think in terms of like switching, it's almost this weird curse. It's like, or maybe the opposite, a blessing for a guy. Every time they touch something, all of a sudden it appreciates in value. And for women, it's like every time they touch it, it like just becomes crappier. I certainly think like not only seeing is still incredibly important because you can't be what you can't see. So the more we have kind of the role models playing that, the more the gender roles swap too, where men are at home doing 50-50 of the work. We hadn't even touched upon how much the invisible load and then is invisible assumptions and almost all this goo that kind of seeps on women of expectations all the time. I always forget how much, like office housework, who's gonna take the notes? The secretary, who, like, and the secretary is usually a woman. Like, all of this, or things that aren't even appreciated by men, you know, like saying goodbye and having a farewell. Like these little small connections kind of fall into the space of women. And I certainly think that the more and more we could have either men doing those things to A, make those things higher, and then B, the ones that where men have overtaken to remember the women in those roles so that it's just as much value. So those are probably the two things I'd recommend.
Thank you so much, Holly. Lisa or Linda, do you have anything to add?
Just to reiterate some of the things that Holly mentioned, not forgetting our hidden figures, because, you know, women did dominate this industry first. I think what's very important is paving that way, giving that payback to, you know, the generation after us so that we are role models, that they have someone to look up to. That's why I am really keen on mentorship. But I think to touch the base of what is it going to take for a woman to penetrate some of the other industries or become leaders, it starts with the leadership of these companies. Just about every company that is a Fortune 500, the leadership are men. Some of that needs to be replaced with women because we'll be able to advocate for each other and pull in more women. So I really think it starts with the leadership of companies, and let's change the story of that.
Thank you. Lisa? We have a couple more minutes. Anything to add?
Linda,
sorry. Okay. Excuse me.
No worries. I think really what I feel in my heart is just, I just want to mahalo you guys for being here. I mean, it just has taken a lot for you to be here. And we, as the, you know, like as Isington said, we stand on the shoulders of giants, but I think that quote is incomplete. I think, and we are, and we will be the shoulders for generations to come is equally important. I think we need to remember that. The other night I went out walking under the stars with two of my teachers, Nainoa Thompson, a master navigator, and Kathy Muneno, and they told me kind of what's been shared earlier today, that whether or not you think it's your turn, it's your turn, and you need to remember that you're not alone. And the story that I share is when I was about 10 years ago, when I started first sailing with the Polynesian Voyaging Society, Nainoa asked me, like, oh, Linda, how much people you think get on the deck of Hokulea? And I looked around and I was like, oh, Nainoa, there's like, super naive answer. I hope this like gets deleted from the recording. And I said, oh, 13? And he goes, no, Linda. There are thousands of people on this deck, on the deck of the canoe, on the deck of life, from past, present, and future generations. They're pulling the lines, they're walking the catwalk, they're checking the sails, they're making sure things are okay. So that's why it's our turn, it's our time to embrace it. This change so that the young Samoan girl and many, many more like her will have that confidence and will know deep within them that we are collectively writing the textbooks of our planet.
Thank you so much, Linda. So I think this has been a great panel to kick off this day of workshops and networking. Let's give a big thank you to our panelists, Linda, Lisa, and Holly. Everyone enjoy your afternoon.